breaking down the new regs for the H-1B visa, the devastating impact of the interim final rules of October 8th, 2020. Welcome to Voice of Immigration. I'm your host, immigration attorney John Veely, and CEO of Online Visas, the intelligent immigration platform. The rules are bad. When do they go into place and what do they do? Well, the DOL rule is in effect right now. So if you're going to apply for an H-1B visa tomorrow, you're going to have to use a new prevailing wage, and they are significant. It is a rise from what was a 17% percentile for the level one wage to a 45 percentile. What that means is it's essentially what was level one is now nearly level three. For DHS, their rule won't go into effect for 60 days. That'll be after the presidential election, and maybe that'll have an impact. But their rules are also very, very significant. What they've done is they've revised the definition and the criteria for the specialty occupation. What that means is that a number of degrees won't work anymore, and moreover, virtually all of the jobs, especially in the tech sector, can no longer work as a specialty occupation. We'll break it down and show you how. Amending the definition of specialty occupation. The rule says the amended definition clarifies that a position would not qualify as a specialty occupation if attainment of a general degree without further specialization is sufficient to qualify for the position. This means the requirement of a general engineering degree for a position of software developer would not satisfy the specific specialty requirement. It goes on to say that a petition for a requirement of an engineering degree in any or all the fields of engineering for a position of software developer would not suffice unless the record establishes how each and every field of study with an engineering degree provides a body of highly specialized knowledge directly relating to the duties and responsibilities of software developer position. It's important to indicate that the use of the word software developer in this example is critical, because we think by reading this, the software developer position, which makes up 40% of all H-1Bs, is no longer a specialty occupation, and I'll show you why. The software developer position's elimination comes in the criteria for the H-1B visa. So the current criteria has words such as normally, required, or common to the industry, or that the knowledge required a position is usually associated with at least bachelor's degree or equivalent. The words normally, common, or usually are not found in the statute and therefore should not appear in the regulation. Those are the words that are used in this interim rule. This change means that the petition will have to establish that the bachelor's degree in a specific specialty occupation or equivalent is a minimum requirement for the entry into the occupation in the United States by showing that it is always the requirement of the occupation as a whole. This is the language in the interim rule, always a requirement for the occupation as a whole. Okay, what they go on to say is these definitions could be read to encompass anything from 51% to 99%. This is what was won in the IT Serve Alliance and other cases that came down in March of 2020, which eliminated DHS's two memos, one from 2010 and 2017, where they really restricted the specialty occupation. This rule is an answer to those cases. So the 51% rule is out. And it has to be, I guess, all of the time. So how is that done by DHS? Well, let's look at what they did. First, they amended 8 CFR 214.2 H43A1 by replacing the word position with occupation. DHS believes that by replacing position with occupation means you will have to fit into their occupational codes, okay? So how does that work? Well, DHS uses the DOL's Occupational Outlook Handbook, the OOH, to assist it in its determinations in regarding the minimum requirements for positions located within a given occupation. That's what it says. In reality, it is exclusively the OOH in which they rely on. So what does that mean? Well, if we go and look at the OOH and we search for software developer under the How to Become One tab, we pull the following language. Software developers usually have a bachelor's degree in computer science and strong computer programming skills. Remember, the new interim final rule says the words normally, common, and usually are not found in the statute and therefore should not appear in the regulation. While this memo does not state it specifically, does this mean a software developer is no longer a specialty occupation and you can't get an H-1B visa under that occupation? Well, the DOL memo says it does. The other one. In its language, a review of the OOH entries for the occupations in which H-1B non-immigrants most commonly work demonstrates that most H-1B workers fall with SOC classifications that include some number of workers who will not qualify for employment in specialty occupations. For instance, the OOH entries for software developers, an occupation accounting for over 40% of all certified LCAs, provides that such workers usually have a bachelor's degree in computer science and strong computer programming skills. So Homeland Security was not so brazen to call out the profession that had comprised 40% of its visas. This is very disruptive to many American employers and the entire economy, and surely will end up in court. So what's left? If we don't have computer developers anymore, software developers anymore, are there any occupations in technology that meets the criteria? Well, first glance shows only one: electrical and electronics engineers. Now remember what they said about any engineers before, right? It has to do with, does their degree connect to it? Let's see what this says. So electrical or electronics engineers must have a bachelor's degree. Okay, check, that's fine. However, if you search the OOH for information technology, computer occupations, or technology jobs, electrical or electronics engineer is not even listed a potential job. And only one of the other jobs listed may meet the standard. Let's look at those. Computer and information research scientists. Most computer and information research scientists need a master's degree in computer science or related field, such as computer engineering. A master's degree usually requires 2 to 3 years of study after earning a bachelor's degree in computer related field, such as computer science or information systems. But this doesn't exactly say all computer and information research scientists require a bachelor's degree, does it? So does it really work? Well, probably, but who knows? Moreover, even if it did, what small percentage of tech jobs would fit into research scientists and electrical engineers? You're going to have to lay out in your job description what your job is and how it's related. And of course, the electrical engineers need to have electronic engineering degrees. Let's go through the OOH and see what jobs are no longer available anymore. So here's a list. Computer network architects usually need at least a bachelor's degree in computer science, information systems, engineering, or a related field. Most computer systems analysts have a bachelor's degree in computer-related field. Most database administrators have a bachelor's degree in an information or computer-related subject such as computer science. Information security analysts usually need at least a bachelor's degree in computer science, information assurance, programming, or a related field. Most employers require network and computer systems administrators to have a bachelor's degree in a field related to computer or information science. Most computer programmers have a bachelor's degree in computer science or related subjects. So none of those jobs under this new interim rule would be specialty occupation. So none of those jobs would get H-1Bs if this rule goes into effect, or moreover, when this rule goes into effect. So what's more, a number of tech-related occupations are not even listed in the OOH. So software architects, quality assurance tester. Therefore, you can't prove it's a requirement. Since USCIS has restricted professions from ONET to OOH, which had a much bigger population, many practitioners have argued these positions were essentially developers. An architect is effectively a senior developer that creates a plan, and a QA tester is a developer that tests whether the application works. But it is too much to say they are electronics engineers, and moreover, the vast majority don't have electronics or electrical engineering degrees. The research scientist is a massive stretch for a job title, and it may be fatally flawed because it doesn't indicate really what degrees are related there as the bachelor's degree. So that's what we have there. The DOL guidelines, the rule strengthening wage protections for temporary and permanent employment of certain aliens in the United States, is its title. This went into effect 10-8-2020 and is a direct punch to the bottom line of U.S. companies. So the rule implements the following prevailing wages: level 1, 45th percentile, level 2, 62nd percentile, level 3, 78th percentile, and level 4, 95th percentile. This is a marked increase over the previous levels of the 17th percentile, 34th, 50th, 67th, respectively. What does this mean? Well, let's look at it. A software developer in Dallas, Texas, if you can still use a software developer, and you can for the next 60 days, the level one wage would be $105,227 a year. The level four would be $171,184 a year. So you compare this with the prevailing wage of the year day before it went into effect on 10/7 for the same job in the same location. The level one is $76,000, level two, $93,000, level three, $110,000, and level four, $127,000. So a massive, massive jump for that. Now that effectively eliminates the staffing companies, the consulting companies, those that place their workers at third locations because they can't mark up the profit anymore. Their margin will be eliminated. It also kills those who are putting their entry-level people into jobs at their locations. So let's go through there. So after the H1B goes into effect, the software developer may not work at all, and then you'd have to use electrical engineers, I guess, if you can make that definition. And so while that's a little bit easier, level one is $93,000 as opposed to $105,000, and level four is $199,000, that's even farther. So while it's not quite as much, remember the problem is whether the job can realistically be described as an electrical engineering position. And again, they said that standard engineering jobs or jobs that require just any engineering job won't work is a big problem. So if it's a really big thing and it's a really big problem. Now, we have talked to a number of litigators who said they're going after this thing. We know that IT Serve Alliance that won the big case on removing the memos that were used to deny H-1B visas back in March 2020. They are going to hire John Wasden. It looks like he's going to litigate. And the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, which just successfully litigated as recently as last Friday, the ban on H-1B visas, is going to go after this too. And they'll be looking at injunctions. So it'll be interesting to see when they do that and how quickly they could get relief and if they get relief. Now, one of the things that's really interesting is that this new regulation as an interim final rule, even though it calls for comment, as an interim final rule, it goes into effect much more quickly. And because of that, it has a higher standard. Now, in reading these rules, and I read them all, there is a lot of logic and persuasion in why USCIS or DHS and DOL did what they did. And that's going to be how they're going to have to argue why they used an interim final rule instead of going through the natural comment component, which would have taken probably 180 days to even, you know, get to where they could do these regulations. So that was one of the reasons that the Chamber of Commerce case was able to overturn the Trump administration on its ban against the H-1B. So they'll be coming at that, and it'll be really interesting to see what arguments they come up with, especially looking at how they attack the DOL arguing why it no longer wanted to use the OES survey, even though it's the best survey and the biggest survey, and go for this different wage. And what they effectively argued is that most of the people in level one and level two under H-1Bs are much more educated and experienced to the Americans that are going into those levels. So let's see if that holds up or not. If you're a company that wants to better understand how these new regs may impact you of hiring H-1B workers, or an individual that wants to apply for an H-1B visa or any other visa, go to onlinevisas.com and schedule a free strategy session. We'd love to talk to you about it. If you're watching on YouTube and you want to stay up with these ever-changing issues, please subscribe and turn on your notification. If you like the content, please click like and please share with your friends. I'm John Veeley, the CEO of Online Visas, the intelligent immigration platform where we deliver dreams.